We have a quorum. This is the appointed time, so I call to order this meeting. This is a special meeting of the panel on constitutional affairs. Well, some members earlier suggested and called for a special meeting on voters' registration system. I accepted the members' request, and that's why we have the special meeting. This is a two-hour meeting, so I will now invite the administration in first. Well, we thank Mr. Ronnie Tong today because this is the last day of his office here, and he is concerned about a lack of quorum, and that is why he has promised to attend this meeting. Well, let me repeat, just now Mr. Ronnie Tong said that he was worried that we might not have a quorum, so he has come to our meeting, and I am grateful for his help, as this is this will be the last meeting that he is attending in this council. So let us move on to agenda item 1, issues concerning voter registration. We have from the administration Mr. Raymond Tam, Secretary for Constitution and Mainland Affairs, and the recently appointed Undersecretary Mr. Ronald Chang, coming as Undersecretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs, and Mr. Gordon Leung, Deputy Secretary, and Mr. Lee Pak Hong, Chief Electoral Officer from the Registration and Electoral Office, Mr. Sham Nam Long, Deputy Chief Electoral Officer, and from the Department of Office, Mr. Ivan Leung, and also Mr. Ryan Chiu, PAS for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs. We have two papers. One is LC paper number CB(22141/1415)(01) from the administration. (02) is another paper from the LegCo Secretariat. So over to you, Secretary. Would you like to walk us through the paper? Members will be very keen to ask questions, I believe. Thank you, Chairman, for arranging this special meeting today so that my team and colleagues from the Department of Justice and the Registration and Electoral Office can brief members on our work on voter registration VR, and also to heed members' views at this stage on enhancement measures. Now, Mr. Ronnie Tong is here, and I'm happy to see him here today, and I hope that in the future we can continue to exchange our views on constitutional affairs in Hong Kong on other platforms. So, Chairman, this is the first meeting that Mr. Ronald Chan is attending as Undersecretary for Constitutional Affairs. So, Chairman, if I may invite Mr. Ronald Chan to walk us through the paper, and Mr. Lee Pak Hong, Chief Electoral Officer, will also give you some background information on voter registration system and their work. All right, Mr. Ronald Chan. Thank you, Chairman. I look forward to cooperating with Chairman Your Good Self and other members in this council in the future. I will speak on two aspects. First, I will say something about the present VR system and the principles, and the underlying principles. And then I will say something about the concerns regarding VR matters and the latest development in this regard. And our ideas on enhancing measures. Now, first of all, on voter registration system or VR system, I want to emphasize that the voting right is a fundamental right safeguarded by the basic law. VR is at present voluntary. Persons fulfilling the relevant criteria may apply for registration as electors, and the design entails three aspects, and we can also consider these three components as the three steps along the flow of work. The first step is applicants or is an applicant's declaration. The existing BR system is based on the principles of honest reporting and facilitation for electors. An applicant applying for registration as an elector will only need to append his or her signature on the form without having to provide any address proof. The next step is verification procedures. Apart from the existing verification procedures, based on the consultation exercise conducted in 2011, the REO has since 2012 implemented a number of enhanced checking measures to enhance the accuracy and the credibility of the DR system and accuracy of the information in the registers of electors. The third step is public inspection. Regarding the provisional registers PR and the omissions lists OL and the final registers, they are available for public inspection for ensuring a high degree of transparency of the registers. And in a public inspection period, the public may lodge claims and objections against the entries in the PR or the OL, and all such cases shall be referred to an independent revising officer, RO, for ruling. And these three steps shows that different stakeholders, namely the public and the REO, play the different roles in the different steps of the electoral process. Well, next I'll come to talk about concerns regarding VR matters. We understand that recently the public has expressed concerns over the voter registration system, including the accuracy of the information in the voters' registers, the objection mechanism, and suspected impersonation of electors in voters' registration. Having considered these concerns, we believe that we can explore in several directions on how to enhance the existing mechanism. First of all, we can review the statutory deadlines of the VR cycle. For example, whether to change the deadline for updating of registration particulars, that is, for example, to advance the deadline to a time before the deadline of the provisional registers, and also to further extend the period for handling claims or objections to allow sufficient time for review of these cases. Next, we can consider how to strike a proper balance between enhancing the current accuracy of electors' particulars and facilitating the electors, including whether it is necessary to reconsider introducing the requirement of address proof and other new requirements. That is, for example, we can consider whether electors should be required to provide address proof when they update their particulars. Thirdly, we can explore how to further improve the checking arrangements. That is, for example, to further enhance the inquiry procedures to further facilitate the electors under inquiry. Fourthly, we can look into whether we should modify the mechanism for lodging claims and objections. For example, we may require objectors to attend hearings and provide concrete evidence to assist the RO in making a ruling to avoid or prevent abuse of the system, and for the relevant officers to deal with the cases more efficiently. Next, we can consider whether to raise the penalty for the relevant offences to enhance deterrence. And finally, we can examine how to strengthen public education. For example, we can promote and encourage electors to use the OVs, Online Voters Information Inquiry System, to check their registration particulars and to submit applications to update their particulars in a timely or as soon as possible once they have changed their address. Now, we should consider whether flexibility should be given to these three steps, because changes in one step may require changes in other steps, and we need to strike an appropriate balance. On the one hand, we need to ensure the integrity, impartiality, fairness and accuracy of the VR system. On the other hand, we need to ensure that eligible residents would be able to register themselves as electors to exercise their voting rights, and we're happy to take comments from members today. And finally, I want to emphasize that the government attaches great importance to the integrity, impartiality of the electoral system, and also attaches great importance to allowing residents to exercise their voting right safeguarded by the basic law. If necessary, definitely, the relevant enforcement agencies would follow up on the suspicious cases. So that more or less concludes my presentation. Next, the REO will say something about the VR system as well. Yes, Chief Electoral Officer Mr. Lee. Thank you, Chairman. On the 25th of September, the REO announced the final register of the 2015 VR cycle. There are 3.69 electors for GCs this year. In there are also over 30,000 electors that have been put on the OL due to death. And overall speaking, the registration rate is 77.3%, a record high. As for the GC, DC second FC, there is a net increase of around 160,000 electors against last year, with a total number of electors being 3.41 million. As for traditional functional constituencies, there are about 230,000 registered electors, of which 2,600 are newly registered. And there's been a reduction by about 3,200, because about 3,700 electors have been deleted from the register because of their eligibility status or death. Starting from the 2012 cycle, the REO has implemented a number of enhanced checking measures, which are set out in the paper. The checking measures would be carried out every year, and during election years, these measures will be enhanced. We'll continue to implement these measures, and we will continue to issue inquiry letters to 82,000 electors. 41,000 electors of them were struck off from the register because of failing to meet the inquiry and requirements. The public can lodge claims and objections after announcement of the provisional registers and omissions lists. And public hearings would be held in a court of law for the revising officer to make a ruling. Altogether, in the 2015 VR cycle, the REO received 49 objection notices, and later on, some of the objections were withdrawn, and in the end, the RO ruled on 1,451 electors involved in the notices of objection, a record high.
The REO has helped the revising officer in judging the cases before decisions made. After the relevant hearing, the revising officer accepted 299 applications, and the relevant registrations have been cancelled. Most cases are to do with voters who have moved to a new address, including those who are living in abolished or buildings to be abolished. And at the same time, the relevant voters could not be contacted, and as such, their registration addresses cannot be confirmed. And the revising officer has also dismissed 1,152 objections against electors in assisting the revising officer. The REO realized that the addresses of some registered addresses of some electors were erroneous due to inadvertent mistakes, and as such, the REO would step up checking measures. We also noticed that there have been a lot of applications in this cycle, and we have received a total of 660,000 applications of objections and complaints, and most of them were received shortly before the deadline, and as such, it creates a burden for the REO. And as such, we would suggest revising our working schedule so that we have enough time to verify the information. The REO would take the experience on board and aim to optimize the registration and checking measures and deal with cases with problematic addresses. We would continue to promote the use of OVs as well as the REO's hotline. We would step up public education and encourage the public to make better use of the website and hotline to verify their registrations and update particulars accordingly. That's all for my part. Thank you very much. The Secretariat has noted the order of questions. Claudia Mo, Mr. En Leung, Mr. Yu Kok-him, Ms. Priscilla Leung, Ms. Dari Lee, Ms. Dr. S. Mack, Mr. Sin Jong Kai, Mr. Albert Ho, Mr. K.K. Kwok, Mr. Lee Chak Yan, and Mr. Chen Kam Lam, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, and Mr. Ray Chan. Anyone else? 4 minutes each, please. Ms. Claudia Mo. Thank you, Chairman. So, do you accept that the existing system is flawed? Of course, you won't describe it as problematic, but we have seen a lot of flaws. You told us about the big picture, and you listed out the current trends. But from what you said, your attitude is still quite tentative, because you said you would consider certain things. So what does it actually mean? So are we having another brainstorming session? You said you have to strike a balance between different things. Since an incident in Mayfu in 2011, in which there have been 7 surnames registered in a single household, there have been issues of vote rigging, and the situation is still very confusing today. I think it's necessary to streamline the existing system. You said you would consider asking people to produce address proofs if they are to be registered as a voter. I think this is the most fundamental and effective method to avoid the issues. Everyone would have some kind of address proof, for example, from the gas or electricity bill. So would you consider this solution seriously? And you gave some general directions, but what about the timeline? Do you have a schedule? Would it happen before the next LegCo election? I think the RO, even the RO, had to speak out because the existing system is flawed. So at the end of the day, I have the right to lodge a complaint against households with multiple surnames. But for the person, for the electors who receive complaints, you have to be fair to them as well. You said those electors have to attend a hearing, so does it mean they have broken the law. So I think the mechanism is flawed. Secretary, I'm sure any system can be improved with time. A few years ago, we responded to suspected cases of vote rigging, and we launched public consultation. And according to the legal papers, the REO has implemented a number of enhanced checking measures, and we have all seen the results. Eventually, more than 200,000 registrations of electors have been cancelled. And today, the situation has changed, and it's different from a few years ago. So we have to think about how we go forward. Chairman, can he not repeat what's been said in the paper? Can he provide a roadmap on the improvement measures? Ms. Mo feels that for new registrations and if the addresses have been changed, as mentioned on our papers, we are willing to make changes. A few years ago, we could not obtain support from the public and the Legislative Council, but we have noticed that in some cases reported to the police recently, some electors suspect that their particulars have been changed maliciously by impersonators. And I feel that if we are to, if we ask them to produce address proof, the situation would improve. So we are willing to take in comments from members, and we remain open on this issue. And on the roadmap, we would try to get things done before the 2016 legislative election cycle, and we would try to amend relevant subsidiary legislation and bylaws. First of all, we have to confirm the measures we are going to take, and we will report back to members. So we will try to get as much done as possible before 2016. Mr. Wong Kwok-Heng. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, the two government officials gave an introduction, and but they did not respond to a recent complaint from one of our members that the home address has been maliciously changed, and surprisingly, the REO accepted the application because the signature on the application form was forged. The dates were wrong. The date given was the 31st of April, which is non-existent. Why would the application be accepted? Just now, the two officials did not act on such cases, and I deeply regret the situation. I'd like the Secretary to tell us what kind of remedies would be in place. And almost 51% or 40,000 electors have had their registrations cancelled, and a lot of them were due to careless mistakes, or they weren't aware that they had to reply to the letters. As I mentioned last time, for electors living in public housing estates, they would often they have often lived there for a long, long time. Right now, we have some 41,000 electors with their registrations cancelled. How many of them are living in public residential estates? So is this, would their inability to vote be due to the government's flaws and mistakes? Let me address the first question first. I'll leave the second to Mr. Lee. Mr. Wong mentioned that your federation has some members of the federation has had their addresses edited. And we agreed earlier that in cases in which a breach of electoral regulations were found, we would launch an investigation and try to prosecute the relevant persons. And as we review our procedures, we recommend three measures. First of all, for many years, even before the handover, we have had deadlines. There's a deadline for new applications and one deadline for making changes. And after the first deadline, we would come up with a provisional register before we allow changes to addresses. And during this period, and some people might make malicious changes based on the provisional registers, and as such, we consider bringing forward the deadline for address changes to an earlier date, so that everyone can see whether the addresses have been changed maliciously. And second, as I mentioned, if we receive any address amendment applications, we would ask the applicant to produce proof of address as well, and this would hopefully cut down on the malicious amendments. And thirdly, we would step up public education to encourage electors to provide other contact methods such as phone numbers and email addresses. So in case of suspicions, the REO can locate the relevant people to see whether their address changes are genuine. Mr. Lee. Mr. Wong mentioned that some 41,000 registrations have been cancelled. Of those, around 23,000 electors live in public residential estates. Mr. Lee, can you speak to the microphone, please? Around 23,000 electors live in public estates. And in our letters of inquiries, we have cross-checked the information with the Housing Authority and Housing Society. Since the information is not inconsistent, electors are asked to confirm the addresses. If we don't receive any replies, then according to the inquiry procedures, we have to cancel their registrations. Out of the 23,000 residents in residential housing, they are highly immobile. I think it's the government's fault that their registrations are cancelled. Mr. Alan Leung, please.
Thank you, Chairman. I think first of all, I need to clarify this with the Secretary, see if he accepts this. Actually, to ensure the accuracy of information in the voters' register, the responsibility lies not with the public, but with the government. And Mr. Andrew Ma, the magistrate sitting as the revising officer, had to deal with over 1,000 cases in less than 2 weeks. And he commented that there wasn't enough time, and he asked whether a balance could be struck and something should be done about the timetable such that more time could be given for him to rule on these cases. On the other hand, he also said that objectors coming forward to file objections have fulfilled their civic duty. But if we rely on the public to make objections to the voters' register as the only means to ensure accuracy of the information in VR, then you can't rule out the possibility of more and more cases in the future. And I'm referring to paragraph 31C, checking arrangements in the paper. And it reads, including reviewing the scope and frequency of various checking measures and enhancing cross-matching with other government departments so as to minimize the chance of having inaccurate registered particulars. I'd like to hear more from the Secretary. How are you going to enhance the measures? As pointed out by Mr. Andrew Ma, that some of the measures are not adequate. So, for example, on enhancing cross-matching with other government departments, we have heard time and again that this would infringe upon people's privacy. Well, are there any new ideas on this front? Secretary. Now, on over 1,000 cases of objection or claims and objection, we agree that the magistrate, as the RO, had to deal with a lot of cases in a rather tight time frame. And he did make some comments. He made various comments, and I don't intend to quote partially his comments here. Now, recently, we have discovered that in some of the cases of objection, the address put down seemed to be non-existent, say 50th floor, although the building only has 49 floors. And I have urged the REO to set up a database. For example, many property agencies also have a similar data banks, so that we can check against the database expeditiously for errors. Mr. Lee. Now, on checking arrangements, it is one of the areas that we should review on. Now, if there are changes in the registered the address is registered, we will help voters in updating the particulars. And we cross-match with other government departments, including the Housing Authority, Housing Department, and the Housing Society, and Home Affairs Department. And we will explore further on how to improve the checking arrangements, because we will think about whether we could get some of the address information from the Housing Department to check against the voters' information. As for private property, so far we don't see a comprehensive database concerning private housing estates, so it's rather difficult. But if we have this database, it will help minimize errors of entries. As for buildings that have been demolished, every time when we check the register, we would ask the buildings department for a list of buildings that have been demolished, because all buildings to be demolished would have to be registered with the buildings department. But still, there is a problem, because after publishing the register, there may still be buildings awaiting to be demolished, and some buildings might have been acquired for 3 or 4 years waiting to be demolished, and yet no registration has been done with the buildings department. So we are considering whether we can or how we can get further information to facilitate our work. For example, if the URA has the relevant information, say if they have some ongoing projects, they can give us information for facilitating our checking work and to ensure that voters' information in the VR is accurate. So we'll try our best to get more information from various government departments in this regard. As for other government departments, we have talked to the RNVD, the Water Supplies Department, and the RRD, Transport Department, We want to see if the information they have will help us check our VR. But still, there are constraints. Maybe legally, there are constraints that prevent them from giving us the information. And perhaps sometimes the address that they have may not be the only residential address of the voters. It may only be a correspondence address, which would not help us check the information in the VR. But anyway, we would review the arrangements. Next, Mr. Yip Kwok Him. Thank you, Chairman. I think this special meeting today is very important because voting rights is very important to each and every citizen. However, we have discovered recently that for some unknown reason, the address of some of the voters has been changed, and then they have become the subject of complaint. The situation is serious. And I think we should let the public know more about the problem, because when the DC election is actually held, they won't be able to receive the poll cards because their particulars may have been changed by others such that they could not check their own entry in the VR, and this is an infringement on their voting right. And I think in terms of data entry, definitely the REO has made some errors. And it may have to do with the lack of a database. There is a need to set up a database. In a recent exchange with the Chief Electoral Officer, Mr. Lee, I also made the same comment. So the crux of the matter is this. Regarding lodging claims and objections, I wonder if the mechanism is being abused. In my constituency, there is a resident who have lived in the area for 30 years, and all of a sudden, he received a notice from the REO requiring him to attend an inquiry hearing. While he has never changed his address after he moved 3 years ago, and yet the address was mysteriously changed to his old address. And then at the same time, there was somebody with the same name who wanted to take part in the election in that constituency. How can you guarantee that the citizen can exercise his voting right? Well, will you make it a requirement for telephone contact telephone number to be provided so that you can contact the voters, or whether you have any measures to prevent the abuse? Any such measures, Under Secretary? Now, two questions. First, whether the address or personal particulars would be changed behind somebody's back. Well, Secretary just now already mentioned a number of areas that we could explore. For example, whether we can advance the statutory deadline before publishing the PR, and also whether we should require the voter to provide email address and telephone numbers to the REO at the time of registration so that we can keep in touch with the voters for inquiries. And we will also explore with the REO whether there are ways to send a message via email or SMS to the relevant voter if his or her particulars are changed, to notify them or to acknowledge their application for updating particulars. And if the voter concerned has never submitted such an application, then the voter can approach us. Of course, we need to consider the operational details. For example, if the particulars are being changed maliciously, then the email address and the phone number may also be changed at the same time. So we have to consider the operational aspect to make sure that the new mechanism would be viable. And we will continue to explore with the REO in this regard. The second question has to do with a possible abuse of the mechanism for lodging claims and objections. Now, I mentioned just now that we would consider whether the mechanism should be modified. That is, we may require the objectors to attend the hearings and explain before the RO their grounds of objection instead of simply filling in a form. We believe that the relevant modification of the mechanism would raise the threshold of objection, and the objector would have to have certain evidence before raising an objection in order to prevent abuse of the mechanism. We are happy to heed your views, Dr. Priscilla Leung. Well, it is definitely a serious crime with mens rea and actus reus for a malicious amendment of voters' particulars. And the government should act expeditiously to find out the culprits, because if the system is all messed up, you won't be able to resolve the problem. And even the magistrate has made some adverse comments in relation to the unclear provisions in the relevant electoral legislation. Our system doesn't really encourage voters to be registered. The law doesn't encourage elections to be held. Now, I have one question. For some residents living in the mainland, they want to know whether they have a voting right. I understand that there, for example, some blue collar workers would come over to Hong Kong to work every day. They may work till 3 or 4 before they go back home to rest. Some of them work round the clock. And they believe that they have paid taxes, but they don't enjoy the right to vote. So they wonder if they have voting right in Hong Kong. They believe that the system is unfair to them.
They are all homegrown Hong Kong people, but because of work or high rents, they have to travel between Hong Kong and the mainland. And if you deprive them of the right to vote, it's unfair. So, Secretary, please make it clear. When we discussed the ordinance last time, we talked about the term valid. In other words, as long as you can prove that the elector has a residence in Hong Kong, then he or she would be valid, even if that person cannot produce address proof. If you can prove that the person resides or frequently visits Hong Kong, then would it be valid? Even for people who go to jail as long as he or she can prove that the person resides in a permanent place, then it's adequate. And these people used to be taxpayers, but now they have to move between Hong Kong and the mainland, and they have all their rights deprived. It's unfair. Later, would you consider this as an administrative issue rather than a legal issue? We are not talking about criminal offenses like vote rigging or impersonation. So if you can make a distinguishment, then you can save the court a lot of resources. So I'd like the Secretary to address this issue on voter registration. Mr. Lee, on Dr. Leung's question, we are dealing with similar cases at the moment as well. And under the existing legislation, there are two relevant conditions. One is that the applicant must be ordinarily residing in Hong Kong, and second, the information provided must be for the purpose of registration. When dealing with the applications, we would look at these two conditions. If a Hong Kong permanent resident spends a lot of time living in the mainland because of work or family reasons, as long as that person still has close links with Hong Kong, so that he or she still ordinarily resides in Hong Kong, then it would pass the test. And if that person can provide a permanent address to which can be treated, which can be seen as the only residence in Hong Kong, then it's valid. We have seen such cases before. You might have seen some from some regular reports that some people might be living in hotels because that might be the place they stay in when they come back to Hong Kong. In those situations, we would try to understand the reasons for leaving Hong Kong and see whether that person has plans to return to Hong Kong and whether that person has any business or family ties in Hong Kong. So we would verify these factors, and we will be careful when dealing with these applications. Of course, we would also consult the DOJ for advice to help us make a decision. So these cases can be dealt with, but they must be looked at from a case-by-case basis. So can we verify their identities beforehand? For example, some workers might receive their tax receipts at the workplace. So for these workers, since they only receive their tax receipts through their company, can they use that address at registration? Now they are rather confused. Can they clarify things ahead of time? I think we should be lenient because the right to be a voter is a basic right. I agree that voter registration and election and the right to elect are basic rights, but we do have to abide by two conditions. One is ordinary residence in Hong Kong. For example, if a person is a taxpayer in Hong Kong, and if that person can prove that he or she still has close ties with Hong Kong, then we would look into the case with the DOJ. And if that person can provide proof of only your principal residence in Hong Kong, then that's also valid. So the key is that that person would stay in a specific residence in Hong Kong. Mr. Lee, Chairman, the meat of the discussion today is to prevent abuse to our registration system. And after a number of media reports, have the relevant enforcement agencies investigated or penalized any cases of malicious abuse to voter particulars. We have received several complaints. One is from Ms. Lam Yuk Chan, district councillor. She's a current district councillor, and her address, her registered address, has been changed maliciously into a phantom address. Now, this is certainly malicious, and without knowing, her address has been amended to a non-existent address. So her registration might have been lost if she didn't find out. So did the REO or enforcement agencies investigated or followed up on the issue? And we also received another complaint that a district councillor complained about a former volunteer and the eligibility to vote has been gone. So these are all malicious attacks. So how would the REO deal with these cases with malicious political intents that's attempts to deprive the voting rights of voters? These are existing cases, and we have to penalize these people who maliciously deprive the voting rights of others. In the current VR cycle, we place great emphasis on the cases mentioned by Ms. Lee. We have seen a lot of cases of malicious address amendments. We have received a total of 23 such cases, and all of them have been dealt with immediately, and they have been referred to the police as well. We have not had results yet on these investigations, but I trust that the police would deal with these matters seriously. Under the existing registration system, it's rather lenient in nature, but it doesn't mean that we would not check the identities of the applicants. Right now, we are relying on the Hong Kong identity card numbers and other information for integrity, and we would vet these information with the Immigration Department to verify the identities of the applicants. As you know, the HKID number is a rather personal set of data, but we feel, we now see that HKID number alone is not enough, because there are lots of ID numbers floating around today. So we would consider using other measures to verify the identities of the applicants. So this is a serious problem we have to consider. How about the second case? A district councillor understands that some people understand that the fellow voters live in the right area, but still objections have been made. If we realize that some malicious amendments to registration particulars have been found, then we would help correct those registration particulars. Dr. Ellis Mack. Dr. Mack mentioned that one of the members of our federation has had his information amended maliciously. You said you conducted more than 1 million checks, but were you able to do your job properly? Do you have enough manpower? Our district councillor amended his own address in March this year, but in June, someone impersonated his signature and changed the address back to his original address. So this was rather blatant, and yet you did not investigate. So you failed to play the role of gatekeeper, and how can we place trust in you in facilitating a fair election? The Secretary mentioned an amendment to the deadlines, but this is rather useless. From the time the REO receives an application form, they have to verify the information on the form. And so we have blatant errors such as the 31st of April, or you know, so the REO has to really do a better job in gatekeeping. And during the election, each candidate has to provide a nomination form. You said that starting from 2015, personal information such as Hong Kong ID, date of birth, and so on would be covered up. So apart from having the Hong Kong ID covered up, all the other personal information has been revealed. How can you safeguard their privacy? And how can you see the persons who have checked their personal information? And with these cases, you can you should try to see who have made checks. As Ms. Lee, this has happened in other places as well. And if during the district council election this year, if an applicant feels that his or her voter registration information has been changed or the address has been changed, would the candidate's eligibility be affected? Mr. Lee, thank you very much. On the illegal amendment of registration particulars, as I mentioned, this is a serious issue that we will deal with. But under the existing system, it's difficult for REO to do anything after receiving an application form. After doing a preliminary check of data, we would enter those information. Mr. Lee, sorry, what did you mean by a preliminary check? On the impersonated form, the date was wrong and a lot of information was missing. Do you call it a complete form? When we deal with the form, we have to ensure that three fields have been filled. First of all, the name of the applicant, Hong Kong ID number, and the address. All these three fields must be present, and the form must be signed. And the Chinese, the CC code is not mandatory. Each Chinese character is given a CC code in exceptional cases, for example, for very rare Chinese characters, we have to resort to the CC code. So this is not a mandatory field. In most cases, voters do not need to include the CC code. So if the three fields I mentioned are present, then we would enter the information to the system. And over the course of data entry, we would cross-check the name and Hong Kong ID with the Immigration Department. If they don't match, we won't go ahead with the application. We realize that some people are in illegal possession of other people's Hong Kong ID numbers, and as such, they might amend their registrations. We would consider coming up with ways to avoid these situations, and we'll look into that in the future.
And you mentioned in the nomination form how we deal with the personal particulars on the form. Now, there is sensitive information on the nomination form, such as the Hong Kong ID card, means of contact, such as telephone number and the address. And as the established practice, sensitive information such as the Hong Kong ID number would be obliterated, and this was implemented not this year, but in the previous cycle. So in terms of the witnesses, the nominees and the candidates, all the personal particulars are covered. And this year, we have tighten up the relevant requirement. Having discussed with the Department of Justice this year, we are going to cover other sensitive information such as telephone number and address as well. As for the name of candidates, they will have to be published in the Gazette, so we cannot do anything about the names. Well, third question. Let's say if somebody wants to stand in the DC election in 2015 and discovers that his address and register has changed, I think your question is whether this person will still be eligible for taking part in the election. Well, according to the present legislation, the most important criteria is that the address registered should belong to that constituency. So on the face of it, it should be all right for that candidate to take part in the election. However, if the registered address is maliciously altered by someone, then there is another problem. But so far, I don't see a conflict here. Mr. Sin Chong Kai, on the number of voters, I want to ask about Annex 4. Is this the most up-to-date information, or do you have an update? You talked about 180,000 new registered, and in 2011, according to legal papers, there were 3.565 million voters, newly registered voters. That's according to legal paper. But now, according to your paper, it's just 180,000. Second question. Well, about raising the threshold for striking off voters in the register, I think you need to be more prudent. If you look at Annex 3 for the grounds of objection, say for an ordinary resident, on reading an address, say Oi Tong House, certain estate, which doesn't even exist, if as a matter of fact the address doesn't exist, then why would you need the objector to provide evidence? How to do that? To inspect the building? So you need to be prudent. For example, item E, buildings already demolished. Well, the building has already been demolished. So how should I prove that? Should I ask the RO to pay the site visit? Well, I'm not all against the requirement for evidence. Say, for example, errors in the particulars registered. However, for some other grounds, you need to be more careful. Let's say if the address is Oi Tong Estate, and then the room number, the floor, the house, none of them is included, then how am I going to prove that this is wrong? You need to be very careful. I have a question for Mr. Lee. That is the poll. That is the poll card. Well, I asked. In previous years, how many poll cards would be returned? Say due to non-existent address, the non-existent voter. Can you tell me how many were returned and what would be done about this? And secretary said that by 2016 the voter register would be ready. I want to say that, of course, in 2016, you will be able to fix this. There won't be any phantom voters because we have constituencies all across Hong Kong, and there may be 100 constituencies or so in which the candidates will return uncontested. So I may be able to manipulate and rig the votes. In the DC election, by changing the address of voters to another constituency to help certain candidate in a contested seat, but not in the case of legislative election. So what we're most concerned about and what is and checking is all the more necessary in a DC election. Secretary. Well, Ms. Claudia Mo asked about the timetable, and I answered that, of course, if necessary, we should strive to enhance the mechanism by implementing enhancement measures before the 2016 cycle. Now, let's look at Annex 3. For 1,451 cases, the grounds of objections were on same residential address with multiple electors or electors with multiple surnames. And according to media reports, many objectors adopted a rather low threshold in raising objection in these cases. Well, Hong Kong is a densely populated place, so it is not really uncommon for people to have the same address with multiple electors and multiple surnames. That is why in the paper and in the open remarks of Undersecretary just now, in this VR cycle, what is unprecedented is that we have seen great surge of cases for claims and objections. In the previous cycle, there was only 86 cases. So we think we need to adopt a targeted approach towards these cases. Now, there may be a small group of people who want to maliciously harm the system, which may affect the rights of 3.69 million voters. So we need to do something about the mechanism to prevent abuse. We'll actively explore the possibilities. Now, on statistics, I'll defer to the CEO. Now, the paper cites that in this VR cycle, we have 180,000 more GC electors. That's comparing to 2014. In 2014, there were 3.57 million voters registered, and this year we have 3.69 million. So there's a net increase of 180,000. So that's comparing to the previous year, not to 2011. And in terms of cases, as usual, during an election year, there will be more poll cards returned. In 2011, more than 80,000 poll cards were returned. In 2012, only 30,000 cards were returned. And these cases would be put under inquiry. And in the majority of cases, the return was due to the change of address of voters, and we would try to contact the voters and see if they could update the particulars. But in our experience, for the majority of cases, it was rather difficult to contact the voters. So in the end, despite our effort, the registration was cancelled for many of these voters. Mr. Albert Ho. Now, I want to follow up on Ms. Starini's point. Now, in the Democratic Party's constituency, an elderly woman was a subject of objection, and then after she came out and explained, we offered apology and we withdrew the objection. However, somebody continued to threaten this elderly lady and said that she should be taken to court. And today, Mr. Lee even used the word assassination as an attempt to threaten the elderly lady. Now, 1,451 cases, only 299 cases were substantiated. That is, their names were struck off from the register. But there were 313 cases in which the particulars were updated. That is, the address were changed from one constituency to another. And therefore, the objection would be very important because these voters should not have registered using that address in the constituency. Secretary, you should understand that there is little we could do as ordinary citizens. And for same residential address with multiple surnames, I've told party members to be prudent in raising objections. And yet, there is indeed ground to suspect in some of the cases. It doesn't mean that without an objection there is no problem. This is in fact the tip of an iceberg. In Kuaiching District, in one of the constituencies, the number of voters registered went down by 800. In another constituency where we're going to field a candidate from our party, there is a net increase of 1,500 voters in the constituency, and we feel very uneasy about the mechanism. Has the government done anything? Has the government, for example, conducted home visits? Now the updated register has been published. But is there any way to object to other suspicious cases? If according to Jiaming Fai versus Kuo Wing Huan, when the case is taken to court, the judge would say that I'm sorry, the person on the register would still be eligible to vote because of lack of objection. So despite any possible error in the VR, the elector registered would still be eligible to vote. So how are you going to resolve this? Mr. Albert Ho talked about a case in Kuaiching, and I believe that it would be an effective way to plug the loophole mentioned by Mr. Albert Ho if we require voters to provide proof of address when they apply for updating the personal particulars. Mr. Lee. Now I want to float an idea. Usually when we talk about incorrect address, we're talking about two possible scenarios. One is that the address is in fact a fake one, a non-existent address, or that the person is using somebody else's address to register, and that is in short vote rigging.
In some cases, for example, like the 1,152 cases mentioned by Albert Ho, 352 cases has had the addresses amended, and in those cases the electors merely forgot to update the information after they moved. So should we consider it a problematic case under the current system if we are to ensure that all the registered addresses are current? Then it's rather difficult. Even after multiple checks, we can only verify the current information, and if there are subsequent amendments, the onus is on the applicant to report these changes. We cannot ensure that all the registration particulars on the registers are most current. As long as the elector doesn't provide any fake address, then the current election the current VR system would allow them to be would allow for some leniency. But for cases of vote rigging, we would take serious action. But for we will seek to prevent these cases. But I think it's very difficult to ensure that the registered addresses are always the most current ones because there's a time gap. And if you are to verify that, you have to verify all 3 million odd voters, which is practically impossible. We have done a lot of checks in the past, and starting from 2012, we enhanced the checking measures, and to this day, we have issued around 440,000 letters of inquiry, and around 300,000 voters have had their registrations cancelled. Most of them could not be contacted to update their addresses, as such the registrations were cancelled. So we can only do our best to update the registration particulars, but we cannot possibly know the current addresses of all the voters. Dr. KK Kwok, I have the impression that the government is playing dumb. Ahead of elections, we realize that some addresses have been moved from smaller to bigger constituencies. I'm sure the REO was aware of that. And right now, the addresses of some elderly people have been amended, and some visits to elderly homes and institutions have been arranged, and even their families weren't aware of these amendments. A lot of these elderly people suffer from dementia, and they were immobile, and as such, they still registered as voters. And some people might try to get some seats for their fellow party members, but if we allow such unfair situations to flourish in Hong Kong, it's a disgrace. And I talked to the EA chairman, Barnabas Fung, and he said nothing could be done. And there was a case in which an office address was provided, and such, and still the government did not know anything. I think the relevant government departments, such as the buildings department, the rates and valuation department, and so on, should know. But yet they have not made any investigations. You allowed these things to happen, and in paragraph 9, you talked about 1.6 million checks being done, how many home visits were actually conducted, and under number 10, you said you would share the information via different channels like fax, phone number, email. What if a voter provides none of these contact methods? What are you going to do? In those cases, would you arrange home visits, and can you provide any figures? And in the figures you quoted, you said some measures can avoid cases of vote rigging, for example, by producing proof of address and introducing stricter penalties. To deter people from providing fake addresses. the government's view is that, according to the consultation results, 60% of the people were against such suggestion. I did not know the scale of the consultation, but if these measures can obviously improve the situation and yet you won't do it, I'm not sure what the government is thinking. And we were talking about universal suffrage by 2017. We were talking about universal suffrage for LegCo. What has the government done? These are prominent issues the government must face. Who can address this question? Mr. Lee? Dr. Kwok mentioned the presence of so-called lamppost address or office addresses in our registers. Well, the fact is, we were aware of all these cases. According to some regular reports, there have been complaints that it's a business address or the address is actually a lamppost or recreation ground. As I mentioned, in other occasions, we were aware of these cases and we have made investigations. For those lamppost addresses, I want to emphasize the fact that in our current registers, no voter has given a lamppost at the address, for some rural areas or electors living rural areas, we would allow them to use lampposts to describe the addresses. For playgrounds or playground addresses, we would be more lenient for street sleepers, and if they can prove via third parties that they reside in those spaces, then it's acceptable, but those cases are rather rare. We cannot say that 100% of these cases have been checked. But we would send our staff to check addresses such as cinemas, warehouses, and so on. We consulted the DOJ, and the view is that as long as a valid address can be provided, we would have to accept the registration. And for voters on the registers, around 400,000 or so have provided an email address. It's not a very high figure, but we would encourage voters to provide their emails so that we can contact them more easily. Around 60 to 70% of voters have provided a phone number, and some of them are still using landlines. So telephone is a primary method of communication, so it's very important that they be provided. As for home visits, normally we won't arrange such visits for voter registration because we have to be legally empowered to conduct such visits, and we have to know what we are going to say or ask of them. So we have to tackle certain legal issues, so we have to be very clear in our objectives and our legal powers. And in the current VR cycle, for those for the voters who wish to be deregistered, then their information must be updated as well. We realized that more than 10,000 voters have no phone numbers or email addresses. And as such, we worked with the Home Affairs Department to help reach out to these 10,000 or so voters and reminding them to respond to our inquiry letters. So home visits are technically difficult to arrange. In a lot of cases, we cannot even enter the housing estates, and some voters do not welcome these visits because it's rather disturbing since they have to be arranged at night. So some families do not prefer to be visited at night about voter registration. Hong Kong is a relatively safe city, but we realize that some people are concerned of thoughts before they open their doors for a visit. They are rather vigilant or alert. So we have to be careful in this measure. So we also have to consider our resources. And in terms of elderly people under the current legislation, we have not set any specific rules for specific groups. For those with psychiatric issues, according to the law, if a person is deemed by the court as unable to take care of him or herself, then that person cannot register as a voter. So we are fair to everyone, including young people and the elderly. If we find that some elderly people has been forced into registering, then this is something we would tackle. According to 6 cases mentioned by the revising officer, they have been those cases have been deferred to the police, and we are waiting for the investigation results. For these 6 cases, most elderly people might not enjoy a very good memory, and they cannot remember whether or not they have personally signed the form. But still, these are suspicious cases which we will deal with. Last, Mr. Lee Chuk-yan, from our discussions today and recent media reports, I think the Secretary, Mr. Raymond Tam, is trying to dodge the attention, and he's trying to dodge the fact that the real problem lies with the system. Instead, he's talking about how to prevent abuse. So the actual problem is yourself rather than people who lodge complaints. So are you trying to put those people who lodge complaints at fault? According to the magistrate, Andrew Ma, lodging complaints in a bid to improve the system is perfectly reasonable. So those people should not be at fault. Right now, you are blaming people who make the complaints, and you are saying that they are abusing the system. So can Mr. Tam clarify the matter? Are you trying to deter people from lodging complaints? Are you trying to encourage vote rigging? The root of the problem is vote rigging, so please don't forget that. We want to avoid vote rigging to ensure a fairer election. So that's the reason why we have a complaint mechanism. And now you are talking about preventing abuse of the system. It doesn't make sense. Mr. Lee mentioned that out of the 1,451 cases, 299 cases had the registrations cancelled, and in 315 cases the addresses were proved incorrect. So I don't see any abuse of this mechanism. But on the other hand, why must the matters be always taken to the court?
There is even cost involved for objectors to attend court. So the problem lies with the whole system. So my question is, first of all, whether you are accusing objectors of abusing the system in a bid to shift your responsibility to others? And secondly, why are the cases objections taken straight to court instead of investigating the case into the cases yourselves? It takes time for the court to process the cases, so why didn't you investigate into these cases first, instead of doing what you should do? You're passing the buck to voters, to others. you say you actively consider introducing the mandatory requirement for address proof. I am all against that because it is very cumbersome for teenagers, for fresh graduates, secondary school leavers. It's very difficult for them to get an address proof. They may not even have opened bank accounts. So can you answer these questions first? Undersecretary. Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I want to emphasize, as per my opening remarks, there are three steps or three fronts in, as far as our VR system is concerned, one of which is public inspection. It is very important, which includes a mechanism for making claims and objections. So are you going to withdraw your remark that you're going to actively consider modifying the mechanism to prevent abuse? Well, in light of the latest situation, as per the concerns expressed by the public, we need to consider whether to modify the mechanism for making claims and objections so that objectors should at least lay down facts for raising objections instead of merely relying on conjecture. I emphasize that the mechanism for making claims and objections is one important component. Objectors, well, you're totally contradicting yourself. On the one hand, you say you encourage people to raise objections. On the other hand, you want to implement measures to make it harder for people to object. I think we need to strike an appropriate balance. On the one hand, we need to ensure that the information in the VR is accurate and that the VR system is credible. On the other hand, I want to say that we need to ensure that voters can exercise their voting right and the registration will not be cancelled or changed at will by others. This is also important as to whether the cases should all cases should be dealt with in court. According to the current legislation, all cases of objections must be dealt with by an independent magistrate as the revising officer. And yet, we have received comments on whether there is room to further enhance the system. Let's say if there are cases that involve technicality matters, technical matters, or cases that may be verified by the REO, then these cases may be dealt with by the REO, and there was a suggestion that only more complex cases should be referred to the RO for ruling, and this is the comment we have received, and we are actively considering whether to considering this comment. That's what I'm saying. You should modify the system in this direction instead of thinking about the mandatory address proof requirement, etc. All right, your point taken. I think he understands. Mr. Chen Kam Nam. Thank you, Chairman. I think the integrity and the accuracy of voters' information in the VR has very much to do with the credibility and integrity of our democratic system. Of course, we should encourage people to make objections if necessary, but they should have evidence to back their objections. What we've heard is that there are cases in which objections were made casually, and these objections might easily lead to some of the registration being struck off. Mysteriously described this as assassinating the voting right of voters. It is a very serious matter. We urge the government to proactively follow up on these cases and trace the culprits, because definitely they've done so with malicious intent. We need to face the issue. We're not trying to put the blame on objectors, but indeed there are those who maliciously do such deed. To attack their political opponents, that is, by changing their particulars in the VR without them knowing, and it's a serious matter that we should look into. We're not trying to stop people from objecting, we're just saying that there should be grounds for objection. Objections should not be made arbitrarily. As the CEO mentioned, the number of cases has surged from several dozen to over 1,000. This shows that some of these cases must have been lodged with malicious intent. At present, we do not require voters to declare any change of address. How are you going to prevent that? Let's say if somebody moves out from one address without notifying the REO, and then another household moves in the address, and this would create the problem of same residential address with multiple surnames. This is not an intentional vote-rigging effort, and the voter has not abused his voting right, because the voter definitely cannot register using both his old and new residential address. How can you prevent this from happening again? So as to ensure the accuracy of information in the VR, what are you going to do about it, apart from sending out letters every year? Yes, you have hundreds of thousands of letters sent out every year, with many of them returned, and yet the problem still exists. Do you have a better way to check the register, Secretary? Thank you, Chairman. First of all, I agree very much with Mr. Chen Kam Lam that we have cases in which the voters' registration particulars have been maliciously amended. We should face the problem. And as mentioned by Undersecretary and the Chief Electoral Officer, we are exploring new measures to tackle the problem. As for the question of moving on the same residential address with multiple surnames, now we have an established mechanism for this. With multiple surnames, the REO would actively conduct inquiry. And once the voter registers again, the inquiry procedure would be initiated very quickly. Now, according to the statistics quoted in a paper, every year there are 200,000 cases or so in which voters would apply for a change of address after moving. You know, moving involves a lot of things, and it's really questionable whether voters would give priority to updating the registration particulars in the VR. Yet I think we should do more in terms of public education publicity. We explored previously the idea whether it would constitute an offense that warrants a penalty for not updating the personal particulars in the VR after moving. And there was a rather strong objection from different political parties, and the idea was then put shelved. So in short, I think we should do more in terms of public education and publicity to urge voters to update their particulars in the VR after changing the address. But as I said, that the inquiry process can be initiated very quickly. Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, I see in para 19, the 2015 FR contains about 3.69 million electors for GCs. And then in para 20, for traditional FCs, the number of registered electors is about 230,000. All right, you confirmed that. My question is this. 3.69 million GC electors. They're going to vote on 35 members, including the DC second FC seats. So why is there such a big difference? Around 4 million electors would vote on 40 GC members. There is a big discrepancy here. Have you been fair? Is that the case? Is that the end of your question, Secretary? Para 19 refers to geographical constituencies, para 20, functional constituencies. I think Mr. Lam Kwok Hong knows the answer to his own question. 3.69 million electors for GCs, of course. In footnote 2 of our paper, we already explained clearly the eligibility criteria as a GC voter. As for para 20, the eligibility criteria for registered FC electors are set out in the relevant legislation. So, Chairman, I have this question. Members across the political spectrum point to the fact that there would be a big problem if you have some voters. You're short of some voters in the constituency. So what's all the talk about fairness? It's not fair here. 3.69 million for 40 GC members, just 230,000 for several dozen FCs. This is so unfair. I'm dissatisfied. You're not going to change it. So save your talk about fairness. Now, 28-8, in relation to the post-vice chancellor election, well, that's really obvious. Why don't you use a password for online banking account, for online gaming account even? You have a password. Why don't you create an account for voters so that they can change the address? You can use an 8-letter or 8-digit password. Give voters a lifelong password at the time when they get, or perhaps when a citizen reaches 18, he or she can automatically be eligible to be registered as a voter, and a password will be generated in the computer system, and that will, of course, solve the problem.
Is this possible? If that's not possible, you can ask me for money. I will help you. Now, the second issue is the database for public residential estates. If there are issues, they would surface immediately. You just have to come up with a computer system. For example, if the tenant is called Wong or Ho, and if the surname is changed, then it will be rejected. All right. So this is very easy. You should, you know, you can contract it out for me. And CY Leng is talking about the ITB. And your 4 minutes is up. CY Leng talked about the concept of smart city under the ITB. Please don't digress. I think CY Leng is talking nonsense, Mr. Ray Chen. Thank you, Chairman. I want to talk about the registration of voters in elderly homes. My mother lives in an elderly home, and she was a victim, and she was suspected to have been manipulated. And in paragraph 17, and these people living in these elderly homes would be classified as households with multiple surnames. So is the you said you will confirm the addresses. Would those checks be done randomly, including in elderly homes? I hope all voters in elderly homes would be checked. And my mother was a victim in the 2011 election, and she was suspected to have been manipulated. And we reported the case to the relevant departments, but due to bad memory and the lack of self-expression skills, the cases could not be pursued further. As Mr. Lee said, was it due to bad memory on the elderly's part, or were they really manipulated? I think this is something we can never find out. If we ask the elderly homes, the answer would certainly be no. They would say, since so many people visit elderly homes, they cannot possibly know. But we would have some reasonable suspicions, because my mother cannot even remember her own ID number. Usually these confirmation, electoral confirmation letters should be sent to family members, but we've never seen any such letters. But at the end, we failed. But so the only thing we could do was to take her away on polling day so that she wouldn't have, she wouldn't be able to vote. And right now it's happening again, and this time we have seen HAD staff sending staff to conduct inspection visits. But is it done randomly or on a recurrent basis? So if there's no confirmation, then the voter won't be eligible. But we were still concerned that would anyone file an amendment application on deadline day? Even if the verification fails, will you further investigate these cases? Or would you wait until the elderly person or family reported to the police and before you would verify the forms against fake signatures? As you know, for an elderly person aged 70 or 80, he or she would probably just follow whatever the nurse says. And I've heard cases in elderly homes in which elderly persons are trained to stamp on number 2 on the form as an exercise. So, were there any successful cases of prosecution or penalty? I have heard similar comments at this panel. Just now, Mr. Chen asked how many of our voters live in elderly homes. According to the past cycles on the current list or registers, we have around 5,000 voters living in 200-odd institutions, and we would cross-check all the information, and we conduct annual fact checks, And we just want to strike a balance so that we won't have to do it every year. So in the 2015 cycle, out of 5,000 voters, we checked 3,000 odd voters. And the previous check was done in 2012. And we understand that some particulars might have changed. For example, some might have disease and some might have moved out, for example. So in executing the checks according to paragraph 27, we would tackle households with multiple surnames. If we have a lot of voters in same household, we would rightly be suspicious. So during the checks, we would ask the elderly people to sign a confirmation letter saying that they would continue to reside there. If the elderly people have issues signing or have problems signing this form, then we would request for help from the institution. Right now, we do not arrange family visits, but as I said, it really has to do with what our objectives are. Have you had any cases of fake signatures or elderly people being forced to sign these applications? We have not seen such cases, but in some recent cases of objections, in line with the revising officer's recommendation, we would visit those elderly persons. And in 6 cases, the electors said they weren't sure if they signed those forms. So these cases were subsequently referred to the police. So as I said, these family visits are rather difficult because it's not easy to communicate with the elderly people. It's even harder on the telephone. So our staff might not be well equipped to conduct formal investigations, but in case of suspicion, for instance, if we cannot recognize the signature, we would refer the cases to the police in order to achieve a deterrent effect. Mr. Raymond Wong. Thank you, Chairman. An unjust election system leads to a chaotic voter registration system. So Mr. Leung Kwok Hong had already given the crux of the problem. Some people talk about vote rigging. I don't even want to go into that. Now let's talk about the voter registration system. The government said the VR system must encompass 3 elements. First, honest report from the applicant. Second, revocation from the REO. And third, public inspection and a mechanism for lodging complaints and complaints and claims. So what did you mean by abuse? So first, the verification of information is important, but no longer how many checks you conduct. You can never have a comprehensive verification. So the integrity of the information is always relative. It can never be absolute. The administration cannot ensure the absolute integrity of the registration information. Our neighboring country is notorious for fake information. And they can mobilize the propaganda machine and resources to pull the votes. So there's certainly abuse in the registration system. It's clear for everyone to see. As such, we have to rely on the verification and inspection mechanisms afterwards to safeguard the integrity. If you just rely on honest reporting from the applicants, it's certainly problematic. So there's certainly abuse in the VR system. You have to rely on the verification and inspection afterwards to protect the data integrity. As long as it's not too disturbing to the voters, you have to step up the checking procedures. Some people say the system is being abused without giving any names. And of the 2,000 objection cases, only 299 voters were eventually taken out of the list. So the objection mechanism might have been abused. But when you look at the government's figures, T2,000 registrations were suspected to be impersonated, but yet only 41,600 registrations were cancelled. The REO has so much resources, and as such, you cannot monitor everything. So how can you blame the NGOs for abusing the complaint mechanism? So we are looking at a few problems. So you might have to review the eligibility of certain addresses. And second, for cases deemed valid by the court, are there still any suspicious cases? If you say those cases are invalid, it's because the complainant fails to produce enough proof. So should the REO be responsible for conducting the investigation and reporting to the court? And out of the 41,000 disqualified cases, have you detected any instances of organized crime? Mr. Lee. Freeman Wong talked about the issue of residence under the existing law. We are happy to take in opinions. And under the current law, there are two conditions. One, ordinary residence in Hong Kong. And second, the registered address must be the only and primary address in Hong Kong. These two conditions are still valid now. And as we assist the revising officer in dealing with the complaint cases, some of them have been rebutted, some have been accepted. We only detected 10 cases of suspicion. So according to the RO's instructions, we referred these cases to the relevant enforcement agencies. Third, the main role of the REO is to assist the revising officer in clarifying personal particulars. Right now, the court is accusing you. So my point is, you must have the responsibility of investigation, and you have to better communicate with the court to avoid similar problems in the future. You cannot merely say you would try to assist them. We are talking about the legal stipulations. So the court had a ruling criticizing the handling of this matter. We have always helped the revising officer. If time permitting, we would try to deal with the cases. And out of the 42,000 disqualified cases, we have not detected any suspicious cases. So in most cases, the voter has moved to a new home, but they could not be reached to update their latest address. So according to the inquiry process, their qualification was cancelled.
Well, Chairman, I want to say that I support most of the ideas that will be explored and as enhancement measures. Dr. Chen Cheng. Now, incidents have happened. People were subjects of complaints, and they had to complain, attend court hearings. And I heard from the community that they feel that it's such a burden to be voters, and then they would be subject to investigation, inquiry, and sometimes it's only because of the in-laws moving in. And these voters are asked to attend court, and some say that they should find a legal representative and make representation. It's really a nuisance. So I am worried that members of the public would be deterred from being registered as voters. So what I'm trying to say is that we are making things more and more complicated. We're causing more and more troubles for ourselves. It's very simple. If somebody wants to be registered as a voter, then so be it. If the voter then moves without notifying the REO and updates the address, then that's it. We're talking about several million voters. You wouldn't be able to handle it, even if you expand your double your establishment. Let's say some voters move from one constituency to another all of a sudden. Perhaps you can pay attention to these cases, and that's it. Instead of causing a nuisance to several million people in Hong Kong, many people are now deterred from, are reluctant to be registered as voters. You're giving them too much work to do. This will happen again in the future, and I am really worried about you. Think about this. Don't do this. And this time, the court has criticized us for being almost ridiculous. And the court has suggested that the law be amended. I think the law should be amended, because we should go through some screening in relation to these cases before they're passed, taken to court. But now, according to the law, these cases would go directly to the court. And it's a very cumbersome procedure. What's meant by the same residential address with multiple surnames? 5 surnames, 7 surnames, 9 surnames? What about a household of chance? Is it that you will investigate into a household with more than 10 voters with a surname Chan? Well, as long as the citizen is a permanent resident and only one address is registered, don't initiate a complex inquiry process for all of them. Do I have to live in the same address for 365 days before I can say that this is the only or principal residence? How about if I have several different residences? How about if I live in my father's place some of the time and my sister's place some other time? Try to streamline things, make things simple, and will you consider amending the law? Secretary, well, let me take your question and I'll see if Mr. Lee has something to add. Now, our requirement is that this is the only or principal residence when the person is in Hong Kong. There is no requirement of the number of days that the person must stay in that residence. Perhaps he may not be able to stay in even one in that residence in even one day, but as long as he has this as the only or principal address, this will do. As for the revising review procedure, before the case is taken to the RO, whether the REO can screen the cases to see if the particulars can be verified on inquiry, and that the objection is not substantiated, and that these cases can be dealt with before it is taken to court and causing a burden on the voters. Legislative amendments will be necessary, and we'll go back and consider it. On this point, we also may need to exchange our views with the judiciary. It may have to do because it involves the workload of the magistrate sitting as revising officer. And we may go back and consider amending the legislation and we'll come back and report to the council. Now, I want to say that this meeting is supposed to be adjourned at 4:30, and it will be extended to 4:45. Mr. Board Chair, I'll be quick, Chairman. In terms of eligibility criteria of voters, the wording is as follows. It is at the time of registration in relation to the particulars. And then the REO may with sufficient reasons make changes. Now, I haven't had time to read through it thoroughly, but things used to be fine. In 2011, only 86 cases. Well, we see such a huge surge of cases this year. Yes, there has been some control, some form of control, but it doesn't mean that we are requiring that the VR be accurate at all times. We're talking about principles. In 1774A, it says that at the time when a citizen applies for an ID card, the person is required to provide an address as a part of his legal responsibility, and the address should be updated when it is changed. Failing to do so would constitute a criminal offense, which attracts a penalty, including one of imprisonment. Well, we all know that voter registration involves only a right to vote, and we emphasize that the ID card number is an important piece of personal data. It is also a means for the enforcement agencies to take action. Now, if we look at our personnel register, we will find numerous errors and cases in which there hasn't been an update of particulars for years. So are we over-rectifying the situation? Is the government being subject to unnecessary political pressure? In particular, there are residential care homes and homes for the elderly. And just now, the secretary mentioned that there will be a heightened inspection effort. Now, about cross-matching with other government departments, there are several avenues, and for PRH residents, it's very unfair to them, as you say, that there will be a comprehensive checking effort. It's a nuisance on them. They're being oppressed because of the so-called comprehensive checking system against PRH tenants. So I don't know whether instead we should rely more on the personal particulars registry so as to prevent duplication of resources and effort. That is, more importantly, we should consider tackling the problem at source by referring to the personnel registry instead of this unnecessary step of verifying information in the VR. Undersecretary, now on the Mr. Porcher's suggestion, we did speak to the Security Bureau. The law at present requires that at the time of registration, the voter must submit an address which is the only or principal residence in Hong Kong. As for registration with the Immigration Department, the requirement is that an address should be provided, and the address could be one of residential address, business address, or correspondence address. So the requirement is different. I'm sorry, Under Secretary, I have to interject. One must provide a mandatory requirement residential address, and then the business address and the correspondence address would be optional. So if there is an address, it can be used as the use in voter's registration. But there is no such requirement of that being the only or principal residence. We have this requirement for VR because we have general geographical constituencies. And we rely on the registered address to find out which constituencies the voters are in. So it's different from the address requirement for ID cards. Unless we amend the law, it's difficult to combine the two. But it's very simple. Whether it's for the purpose of ID card or voters registration, the requirement should be that it's a genuine address. I think these two could be combined. I don't want to argue with you, but could you at least consider this idea? Well, Chairman, now, if a resident moves his home, there is a big difference in terms of consequence for failing to inform the relevant departments. Now, there is a consequence for not informing the personal data registry, but not so in the VR system. I understand that Mr. Paul Chair would like to use this as a means to urge voters to update their personal particulars. The voter must act on his own volition in updating the address, whether in the VR or in the personal data registry. We may have to step up our publicity effort. We'll go back and consider Mr. Paul Chair's comment. Anyway, we're going to come back and report to this panel after we consider different options, and we'll consider whether this is also a possible avenue. Well, but I have a concern. Let's say if you register as a voter, and if you make it an offense which attracts a fine, imprisonment for failing to update the personal particulars in the VR if you move, then you will deter voters from being registered as voters. So why don't you just scrap this ordinance, personal registration ordinance? But if you peg the system to the ordinance, then this may be exaggerated by others. Well, Chairman, you have also made some comments, so I'd like to respond to you. And it is true that this is a concern among some members of the public. Several years ago, we explored the idea of whether we should penalize those who fail to inform the and update the address, and many voters would rather not become voters because of that. And I recall on the radio program, a member of the public phoned in and said that as a result, the caller would not want to be registered as a voter.
So perhaps they did not know that they have to update the HKID and other particulars. You just have to educate them. All along, you have not enforced the law, which was wrong. So the actual execution of the legislation is something you have to work with the Security Bureau. I'd like to add by saying that you have heard a lot of comments from members, and there are things you have to adjust. For example, a lot of members have mentioned the role of REO in assisting the RO. I think the SEO must first conduct all the preliminary work before handing over to the revising officer, and this is also to prevent abuse. Right now, you just have to say, the complainant just have to say he or she suspects someone is ineligible, but then the electors would have to be would have to respond. And we have not seen a lot of problems in the past, but it doesn't mean we won't have issues in the future. More than 1,400 cases or complaints were raised by members of the Democratic Party. So hopefully this is something you will solve before 2016. A lot of members wants the REO to play a better role of gatekeeper, and I agree with this as well. As Dr. An Cheng mentioned, can we revise the review process so that the REO would first conduct an investigation to confirm whether the data is correct or not? And as such, these two types of cases won't have to be deferred to the court. So that's the residents or members or public members involved won't have to deal with any nuisance. So we would study the matter further with law enforcement agencies, and we will report the latest progress to the panel. And our paper lists out some general principles, but in the actual execution, we would make some adjustments. Once you have any decisions, please come back to us. Any other business? That's all for the meeting. Thank you very much.